All right. Welcome, everyone. Mic up so that the people who are visiting us from Second Life and on the streaming web can hear me. Welcome, everyone. Glad you could all make it. We've got a great turnout tonight. For those of you who do not know who I am Dr. J.D. Armstrong. I'm the person that puts together these talks as part of my job here. It's one of the funner parts of my job because I get to meet interesting people and bring them over to our community to have them give talks. And this week's interesting person is Dr. Adalbert. Did I say that correctly? Adalbert Ding. Of course, those of you who do know me know I will get in trouble if I do not get out my notes. So Dr. Ding received his diploma in physics and then his PhD in chemistry. He did his postdoctoral work in Toronto, working on basically the physics of ions. He then later started working with clusters and nanotubes, primarily. But in the last 2 years, he's been working with one of the faculty over on Oahu, Dr. Shadi Habal. And so we've dragged him into solar physics. But that's not what he's going to be talking about today. Today he's going to be talking about one of his, as he describes it, hobbies. And on his on our drive up here from the airport, I learned that he's on dissertation committees with this hobby, and I got the impression that he's really the expert at his university on this subject. Is that not? Okay, but if he's not the expert, he's one of the experts. I think we can at least get him to admit to that. So I'd appreciate if everyone would give a nice Maui welcome to Dr. Adalbert Ding.
Hello. Yep. Ladies and gentlemen, can you hear me?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
I am glad to be here on Maui. It's first time in my life. The whole story started at the last solar eclipse in Tatakota, the atoll in French Polynesia, where I met Hao Sheng, and we talked about all sorts of things, and so I told him that I do some hobby musicology, and then he said, well, you have to come to Maui and give a talk. And that's actually when I came here in end of January, when he came over, he said, you have to give a talk, and so that's how it all started. And so I'm giving a talk now on the physics. Actually, I'm giving a lecture in Berlin called The Physics of Musical Instruments. And when we had the tsunami and all the tsunami warnings in Honolulu, I thought, well, waves are all the same. And so why not take a comparison with the waves you can get from a tsunami with the waves you get from musical instruments. And as I had this picture, I have to switch over. Occasionally I have to switch over to from a famous cartoonist, Gerhard Hoffnung, who made a lot of these musicians' cartoons. You probably have seen them. And this lady playing the Wagner tuba, you see this is a face of Wagner, and she playing in the figure of Brunhilde, and so I thought we put those two things together, and I will say something about waves in general and in particular acoustic waves. So what have a tuba and a tsunami in common? At first I would say nothing, but if you really look, they both deal with the generation and the propagation of waves. And there are very many things which are very similar. And what are waves? Waves are periodic processes in time and space. You all know it. You have to only to look out of the window and then you see the waves. But there are other waves than you can see. What you see are two-dimensional waves, surface waves, and there are actually three-dimensional waves. When you have a tsunami, you have actually a three-dimensional wave, and you have one-dimensional waves which go along a string or actually on cables as well. We have all the bunch of waves which you have to deal with. Now, I just distinguish between three types of waves, and that will be the last, what I will say in general about waves. That's mechanical waves, where you have mechanical forces, water waves, of course in liquids, usually in water, earthquake waves, mainly in solid state material, also in liquid, because when they go through the core of the earth and they go through liquid, and sound waves, which are mainly in gases, but also in liquids and in solid state. Then, what we all depend on with our cell phones and so on, are electromagnetic waves, radio waves, microwaves, and also light, infrared, visible, UV, X-rays, gamma rays, cosmic rays. And then we have another type of waves, as are so-called material waves, which are, when you have particles, very small particles, they behave like waves and they have all the same properties. For instance, electrons, and you couldn't have an electron microscope if you wouldn't have particle waves. So how do you describe waves? You describe waves by the wavelengths, the frequency, and the speed. The wavelength is, I can use this. The wavelength is the distance between, say, two maxima. And when you have a tube and you waggle it, and then you get waves going out of the tube. The wavelength is the distance between the two adjacent peaks. This is electric field. I stole that from an astronomy book. That's not acoustic field, and the frequency is the number of times a particular position of the wave will go up and down per second. So if you have acoustic waves and you have a wavelength of 30 foot, you have this equation, wavelength times frequency is the speed of the wave. That's a general equation. So and the speed of the sound wave is for in air is normally 1,000 feet per second, approximately 340 meters per second. In water it's faster, and in solid state it's even faster. It's about 5 times faster in water, 15 times faster in the solid. Depends on what solid you're using. So if you have a 30 foot wave, then you have a frequency of about 35 hertz. If you have this 2.35 foot wave, I chose it to get the frequency of 440 hertz, which is a tuning frequency for most of the instruments. And if you have a 1 inch wavelength, then you go up to 12,500 hertz, which is about the last what you can hear. Young people can hear more, but when you get older, then you don't hear. Finally, it's until you don't hear at all. But even famous people Beethoven couldn't hear and wrote music. The best of his music he wrote when he was deaf. So two things. Physicists always try to make things easy for them. So they make everything linear, which is, of course, not what nature is. So we have two important things with waves. They superimpose linearly most of the time. That means when they are sometimes they are non-linear. That means if you have two waves going, say, crossing each other, then you get the sum of the two waves as a result. It's very simple to calculate. And then they have diffraction and reflection. And diffraction and reflection you can actually see everywhere, even with water waves. And we have here two pictures. One picture, they are actually from Cannes, the French Riviera. So you see here you have two waves coming in, some like here, and from different direction, and you see they interfere with each other. You have parts where you don't have any waves. And when you really look, they have a ponton or a boat. When the waves, these are just, we would call them sort of monochromatic waves, this was one wavelength. They are diffracted from this object here and go around it with, when you put a stone in the water, you get circular waves, and if they interfere, then you get those patterns which you can see here. So actually, waves all behave the same. Whatever you do, they have a speed, they have diffraction, and if you have to be observant, and then you can observe all the things with water waves that you can see with light waves, for instance. So, if you put waves into an enclosed space, then these waves will be reflected from the walls, and they will interfere with themselves. You have only to do that when you're in the bathtub, and play around, and you have the waves going back and forth. And only certain wavelengths will be such that these waves will persist. Others, the waves will interfere and just cancel each other. We call that interfere destructively. These frequencies, which are connected with those waves, they are called eigenfrequencies and eigenmodes. And that's essentially all what it is for musical instruments in the end, and also for water waves. When you have particular cases, one-dimensional cases, then these eigenfrequencies are normally integer multiple of one basic wave. And we will see that later with strings and with trumpets and so on. Here is a demonstration. You have a wave coming in here through a hole or through a not closed barrier, and that will be reflected from the ends and will go back and forth, and it will overlap, and only the waves which have nodes at the side will persist. So you have either half a wavelength within the two reflecting walls, or one wavelength, or one and a half, and then two, and so on. Actually, this is the principle of a laser. You have two mirrors at the side, and you get those eigenstates, standing waves in the so-called resonator. If you have complicated or surroundings, then those we get still eigenfrequencies. They're a bit more complicated and difficult to calculate. Now, when you have a resonator and you tune the frequency through the through the so-called resonance, then you will increase the amplitude. The amplitude is a path in water waves where it just goes up and down. And depending how much energy you lose, you get a peak which is higher or lower. So if it's lower, then you have to lose energy. We call that damping. And that plays a big role in all oscillating machines. If you want to have very narrow resonance peaks, then you have to see that the damping is not too large. I have to come to something a bit more difficult. I will just describe it. There is another property of the material, actually, that's called the wave impedance. You have that for all waves. And the wave impedance is sort of a ratio of a force or pressure over a velocity. And this is a particular important feature, because that tells you how a wave is going through a surface with different wave impedances. You have the wave impedance, you know it from optics. When you have a window, you get reflections. And that's because the wave impedance in the glass is different from the outside. So if you want to have a good coupling into something like that, you have to see that the wave impedance is either identical, or you have to code the surfaces in a particular manner, so that either the wave impedance slowly goes from one side to the other side, or you have multi-layer. When you have glasses with this anti-reflective surface, and that's exactly what these anti-reflective surfaces do. They see that the interference of the waves will result in no reflection, at least for one wavelength. I'm using that because it's important for tsunamis. Tsunamis, of course, water waves, they have also wave impedances. And it depends, in the free water wave, it depends on free wave on the velocity and on the density. But that's not really important. Now, we are coming to two different interfaces. If you have a water wave or any other wave, and you have a discontinuous change in the wave impedance, then this water wave will be reflected, even if the water is above the step. You can see that in swimming pools. When you have a swimming pool, you have a deep part and a shallow part, and the wave goes over the edge from the deep to the shallow part, you see that the waves are reflected. And that's, if you have a tsunami, the same happens. So if you, where do you have such discontinuous changes in water depths? At atolls, or at islands which are on a socket which goes fast in. If you have, on the other hand, a sloping coast, then you change this wave impedance slowly, and that means the speed of the wave decreases, and as you have always the same energy per time, then the waves increase. I mean, I think in Maui you have a particular case. I will show you in a moment. The waves, they were measured at the last tsunami, and here's again, you have a very shallow wave of a foot or so, and then it comes nearer to the coast, and then it starts to go up and up, and then the speed of the wave is depending on the height. So if it's higher, it's faster. So the top of the wave starts to go faster than the bottom of the wave, and so they break the wave. That's essentially the reason that the waves break. And down here you see that I got that, I think, from Sweden. And when you have a 7,000 meter depth, then you have about a speed of nearly 1,000 kilometers per hour. Well, I'm not so sure. Anyway, and the wavelength is about 300 kilometers, quite large. And when you come to the coast, that's 10 meters, then you have only 36 kilometers an hour and wavelength of 10 kilometers. So the waves become slower and become higher. And you can see that. I mean, if you look at the videos, where there are plenty of videos around, you can see actually what that happens like that. Here you can see the same again. You have the long wavelengths, and if you come nearer to the coast, shallower coast, and then they actually break the waves. This is the measurements from the last tsunami on 11th of March. I had been in Honolulu at the time, and we were alerted by the sirens, and then it was difficult to find out what would happen. I mean, I live at a part which is very high, so there was no danger of the tsunami. They evacuated all the low-lying areas. I guess they did it here as well. And this is actually calculation and measurement. And you can see this is local. You can see the measurement and the calculation are fairly good. But here in Kahului, you have nearly 2 meters of wavelength. And I saw pictures, they had some damage in the harbor, didn't they? And you see, of course, Wake Islands, Midway Islands, Honolulu, and then Pago Pago is the Solomon Islands. You have very different wave heights, and it's different on the part of the island where you are. If you have a flood sloping beach, then it's worse. But I think all the Hawaiian Islands are fairly steep, and at least when you go out over the coral reef.
What may be the polar elevation at the Wake Islands?
Yes, because it depends on the slope. So if you obviously the place where they measure this it goes steep down, and then when you look at those simulations, I will show you one. You see that they come to the island and are reflected or just scattered around it. So, for instance, there is at the tsunami in Indonesia, say the Maldives. Got it as well. Sri Lanka got it very badly, and Burma didn't get anything. I mean, there was at least I hadn't seen any. So it depends really on the coastline, how the coastline shapes. And in Phuket, where they had most of the trouble, if you look on the map, it's very shallow. So it's coming up and becoming higher and higher. And there are simulations. It goes around. It goes to Africa. Then it goes around Australia. It goes into the Pacific. Goes up to North America. It's quite different. I will show you a movie in a moment. So that was nearly all what I wanted to see on tsunamis. And now we're coming to the main topic of the evening: sound waves and some basics about sound waves. A sound wave is a pressure wave. Water waves are so-called transversal waves. They go up most of it. I mean, in the water, they are a bit different. And sound wave is a pressure wave, a longitudinal pressure wave. But it doesn't matter, really. It's from the wave is a wave. And so we are discussing the points. Is sound... tone, is it tone or noise or both? And how do we generate sound and how do we analyze sound? That's the topics we will discuss. And for that, I want to show you a general picture. You have a sound generator on the left side, the green. The sound receiver on the right side is actually this you can use for everything, for electrical signals, for mechanical signals, for sound signals, and for tsunamis. To create a wave, you need a generator. Then you usually have some sort of filter. For sound, you have actually secondary filters as well. And then you have something to couple the signal into space or into water. And then you get a wave. The wave travels to the receiver. You have a receiver here, again, filters, and they have some processing or storage. If you look at it for the humans, say the two talking or communicating people who communicate with each other, then the generator would be your larynx, the filter would be your mouth, a nose and throat, and that would be your mouse. And if you want to be very loud, then you use some of those, I don't know what the English expression is, megaphones, yes, to increase the coupling from your mouse to the surrounding. Then you have your wave. This is your ear. Then in the ear you have filters inside, and then this is your brain, which processes what you hear. Now, you can apply this to tsunami as well. So the generator would be the earth plate which had been moved down. The filters is the ground of the sea, how it's shaped. Then this could be, say, a chain of islands, and then they have an opening. If not, then you would get this wave impedance the same as in the free water. Then you have the traveling wave, and this is your beach, which is going either slowly up or perpendicular up. And of course, then this filter might be the houses which are destroyed. So, I want to show you a few things now. I have always to switch between the two computers. This is okay. Let me. Oh, sorry, it was the wrong. It was the wrong. So, I'll show you just a short clip. This is... you can't, because I haven't got the Celeste. Okay. Starting again. Okay. So this is a movie.
Following the animation shows Japanese tsunami propagating throughout the Pacific Ocean. As the tsunami radiates from Japan, it encounters complex topography and bathymetry in form of ridges and volcanoes that create this complex wave pattern of scattering and reflected waves. By the 8-hour mark, the tsunami had encountered the Hawaiian Islands populated areas. After 9.5 hours, it was hitting the west coast of the United States. Notice how complex this wave pattern is becoming as it encountered more topography and more bathymetry.
Yes.
And now you're seeing reflected and refracted waves.
Reflected waves.
The tsunami now has propagated throughout the Pacific and is entering the Indian Ocean and enveloping the New Zealand Islands. At 22-hour mark, the tsunami had propagated throughout the entire Pacific Ocean. One way to simplify the interpretation of this complex wave field is to compute the tsunami energy pattern shown on this map. The red colors indicate where the maximum force was directed.
So, this was from NOAA calculation. They're fairly accurate, as I showed you. And you have seen the depths of the ocean influences very strongly the properties of the waves. And if I would do the same with acoustic waves, you could actually do the same, and there are programs to do it. You can visualize how an acoustic wave goes through a room, and then you would see more or less the same. So now. So this is again our example for the transmitter. Or I wanted to say, in the old times when you had TVs with antennas, then this would be the generator, high frequency generator, the filters you would have in the electronics. Then you would have an antenna here. I mean, it's the same for cell phones. Then you have your waves, and you have your receiving antenna. And I don't know if you know Yagi antennas with the little stubs on the antenna. Actually, what they do, they slow down the wave. That's the idea, because they interfere with the wave, and then it becomes slower and higher, so you have more electric field, more voltage on the. That's a trick. So, how do we generate, or what sound signal can we generate? There's one thing which is the oldest sound signal, the human voice, which is vibration of your glottis, and you just operate it with muscles. And you have to learn that when you're little, otherwise. Animals can't do it because they are not so sophisticated what their muscles with the movement of their muscles in the glottis. Then you can generate sound pressure by loudspeakers like we have here. And then we have two types of instruments. One is the so-called acoustic instruments, so like a tuba or trumpet or a violin. And then... stupid. violin or any guitar, acoustic guitar, and the other electronic instruments where you produce a vibration electrically with loudspeakers or with strings and which are electrically or with coils. So we will talk about acoustic instruments, not electronic instruments, and a bit about the human voice. And then the reception. I already said for humans and animals, you transform the sound pressure into nerve signals, into electrical signals, and the processing is done in the brain. You have a sort of filters in your ear, which are mechanical, so it's a mechanical electrical thing. With a machine, you transform the sound pressure into an electrical signal. So if you have a microphone here, then you have filters. I mean, you know probably when you have a hi-fi set at home, you have so-called equalizers. The equalizers are sort of the filters. You can set them like you like, and then you process them or store them. Compress them, whatever you like to do. So, how do we process and analyze sound signals? We take the sound signal and have to record it somehow, and then we have to display it in a manner where you can see how it works. But before I say anything about that, I would just like to say a few words about the type of instruments we are dealing with. There are, we have four types, so-called aerophones, that means instruments with air, like trumpet, flute, tuba, clarinet, I mean all the wood, we call them woodwind instruments. Then idiophones, like a vibraphone. Sometimes you put a piano in, sometimes you put a piano to the chordophones. Then membranophones, timpani if you have a membrane, which is quite different from a string or from a trumpet. And chordophones, violin, guitar with strings. So I will, in this talk, only deal with aerophones, with trumpets, a tuba, and with a violin, and the recorder. I should stop. Okay, I go back. Sorry. So, we'll first talk about wind instruments. That means the trumpets and flutes. And you have four different kinds of wind instruments: the ones which have a cylindrical tube, the ones which have a conical tube opening, and the ones which have a conical tube closing. The cylindrical instrument is some kind of flutes. An oboe is a conical instrument, and a recorder, like this one, is a conical instrument, but where the cross section becomes smaller when it goes out. And then you have those instruments where you have only one space. When you have a bottle, for instance, blow on a bottle, these instruments are used in, say, in Asia and ancient instruments in China and Sumatra and so on. Then you this is a part which you will where the sound is transformed, and then you have to generate the sound, and it generates the sound either by blowing on a hole or on an edge, or you have sort of a reed which vibrates, or you have something else that vibrates, namely the lips of your mouth, and you have the trumpet. And for the human voice, you have the lips of your glottis, which vibrate as well, very similar to the lips of your mouth. And so the human voice is very similar to, say, a brass instrument. So here we have the two shapes, or we have actually the four shapes. These two shapes, conical shape and the cylindrical shape, they produce tones which we call harmonic. And the other two don't. The other two don't. So you can't use them for proper instruments. They would. I will say something about harmonic generation. They would make tones which sounds awful. So what happens is if you have an open tube like in a flute. At the end, you can't have pressure because the tube is open. So you have, as I showed you, half a wavelength inside, and the maximum pressure is in the middle. Or you have one wavelength inside, and but always the pressure is zero at the end. The red is the pressure, and the motion of the molecules is in blue. So at the end, you have the most motion because they can move in and out. In the middle, they can't move in and out. So you have one half a wavelength, one and a half wavelength. So you produce tones which are integer multiples of half a wavelength. When you have one side closed, then the pressure has to be very high. So you can either have quarter of a wavelength or one and a quarter of a wavelength. So you don't produce every integer, but every second integer of these tones. And when you have a conical piece, then you have again a quarter of a wavelength, one and a quarter of a wavelength, one and two and a quarter of a wavelength. So you have similar conditions as you have when you have an open a tube. And here this would be an oboe, in the middle would be a clarinet. The clarinet is quite different, that's why it sounds so different from the other instruments. So I'll leave this as essentially the same again, but measured. Now, we saw that the tone, the height of the tone depended on the length of the tube. Now, there are two ways of changing the length of the tube. One is using valves. You have an extra U-bend here, where you exchange, makes the tube longer. And if you have several of those U-bends with different combinations, then you can get actually play tones of quite a range, which I will explain later. And the other way is you make holes in the tubes. And when you make holes in the tube, then it depends how big the hole is. Then you get an effective length of the tube. If you have a small hole, the tube won't notice. And if it's bigger, the effective length goes down. When the hole is very big, then you have just the length to the hole. And this is, if you ever have looked at recorders, you see that the holes are different. Why are they different? Why? Because you have to play them with your fingers. You could, of course, make them all equal, but then they would have been at a position which you couldn't put your fingers on. So what they do, they make the effective length so that it fits with the tone and make the holes appropriately large. So here we have the principle of a trumpet, of three instruments. I will only look at the trumpet. The say modern brass instrument. If you have a mouthpiece, can I have one of you? So this is our mouthpiece that goes onto the lips and presses on the lips so that the lips can vibrate. And the mouthpieces are different. You will see it later. There's a tuba, and then you have a piece of tubing with valves or without valves, and in the old instruments they had holes in, so you could actually change the length by closing the holes. And then you have something what I described. You need to couple to the free space, and this is the flare and the bell. The flare and the bell is used to get the impedance continuous into the free room. But it's difficult with brass instruments, because the brass instruments, you start, you try to do standing waves in here. So if it's too well if the impedance is too well coupled into this free room, then you don't get any reflections. And this depends on the tone and the height of the tone. The higher the tone, the less reflections you get. And that's why it's difficult to play brass instruments at very high tones. Yeah. And the jazz players, they use sort of a little round thing to put in front of the trumpet to get the resonances better. So here's the mouthpiece, which I just showed to you. So the mouthpiece, the lips will be sitting on the mouthpiece, often unsymmetrical, and then they will open up and close and open up and close and make the excitation of generate the excitation of the tube. And you have different types of mouthpieces, different tapers, different, some are round here, some are conical here. Depends on what kind of tones you want to generate. Yeah. How do those what do the lips generate in terms of air pulses. The lips open, then you get an air pulse through, then they close again for a while. Then they open and close. When you blow on something like a reed or something like that. And what has that an effect? What will the effect be for the tone which comes out? And you will get a pulse which is repeated. It's a repeated pulse with a and this repeated pulse you can simulate by sine waves, which are sort of standing waves between adjacent pulses. So you get a sine wave, sum of sine waves, which with integer the number of wavelengths to describe your pulse. And this is just how you would do it. This is called Fourier synthesis. And you see here you have three sine waves with a ground frequency, double the frequency, triple the frequency. You have six sine waves with single frequency, double, triple, six times the frequency. And these sine waves have different intensities. And if you look, if you calculate them, then usually the lowest one is the highest intensity and the higher ones are lower intensities. And those are called the overtones of these pulses, and they play a role in with these instruments, and I will just show you something, how they look like when you have particular pulses. You have to change that. So we are. No. So here we have displayed over the time. Time is in this axis, and here's the intensity or the symmetry. So this is a vibration. See, zero, plus and minus. And I'm just enlarging that you can see what it looks like. So this is a sawtooth wave, and this program can find out what the frequencies are in this. What I showed you, this is the parameters of the different sine waves by calculating the so-called Fourier analysis of these waves, and that looks like this. So you can see, and here's the frequency is plotted here, and here's plotted the time. That's called a sonogram. And when you can make a cut through it, then you see that you have all for many frequencies. Here's a frequency, 100 hertz, 200 hertz, 300 hertz, 400, and so on. You get all those frequencies for this triangular-shaped a signal. And essentially, when you have a trumpet, when you have periodic pulses, then you get the same sort of a picture. Depending if the pulse is very short, then you get very high of so-called harmonics. If the pulse is longer and softer, then you get not so many. And you have to imagine that this is sort of a three-dimensional picture. The blue lines are out of sort of rifts of mountains going along here, and what I did just was to cut through it. So this is a triangular wave. Now I will show you how a square wave looks like, and then we will in the end just use the music and put it into this program, and then you can see what harmonics will be in what part of the music. The difference for a real Fourier transformation is that you here take only a part, a certain amount of time. You take, say, a tenth of a second and then do the analysis, and then another tenth of a second and move that through. When you have quickly changing sound patterns, then that may pose a problem. So, here's again. This is a square wave. These oscillation on the edges, that's artifacts, that's just from graphic plotting of this. So they're real square waves. So I should analyze and then I should play them for you. So, and here you see when you have a square wave, you have the ground frequency, the second one is missing, then you have a third one, the fourth one is missing, and so on. That's because of the symmetry of the square wave. Now we can play that. I will take. So. Oh, we have two. Can we. We have to. Can you turn the loudspeaker down? So, yeah. Okay. So, no. To see. So this is a square wave. Now go back to the triangulars. Okay. No, triangular wave. That sounds like that. That's always repeated. It's and now, if you take a sine wave, you can see this is a sine wave, and so. You hear the difference. A sine wave is much softer, and the more higher harmonics you have, the harder the sound will appear. Okay. Now, I will go back to the other computer. So we are going proceeding to the actual instruments. These are different brass instruments. That's unfortunately in German. It's from a book. It's a French horn, a trumpet, and then there are special instruments and a trombone here, and. The trombone again. The trombone, you don't use valves. You extend the tubing by sliding one U tube into another one, which is always a problem because you have to really airtight. And then when they're not airtight, then you get tones which are not be there. And some of the trombones have additional valves to get a higher a range of notes. Again, the French horn, then they have so-called double horns where you have actually two systems in it, different keys. so that you can change between one and the other. Look, see, these are old ones. And then the instrument which we have here is a tuba. It's not a very old instrument. It's only 150 years old. And the American equivalent is a sousaphone. You've probably seen the sousaphone invented by Sousa, and it's easier to carry because you put it over your shoulder and then it radiates to the outside. While in European bands, they use more tubas and things like that. And you have different sizes. If you look at the instruments, you see they have different ranges, very small range actually, if you compare them with a piano, with an organ, but 2.5 octaves. And the highest tone depends always how good the player is. Because we will show you in a moment these resonance curves where they are sharp at lower frequencies, but at higher frequency become rather broad, and then it's very difficult to excite them. The lips have to be very well controlled, and so people who are not experts, they don't get the tones correctly, and secondly, they get tired very quickly. That's another thing. If you're a brass player, I think I'm right, you have to have pauses in between. You can't say play 2 hours without interruption because the lips become tired and then you don't produce any good sounds. In a moment we will do a demonstration. But I have some already recorded sounds. You can play a brass instrument or any instrument, mezzo, quiet and louder and very loud. And depending on how you play it, the overtones change. And we will see that in a moment. And then when the envelopes look like that, I mean, here you can see the loudness from the extent of the tone. And if you look at the overtones, then you see that you have quite a lot of overtones. This is from the tuba, you have at least 50 overtones. And they're not all equal. That's another thing. You see those gaps in here. And this is typical for the instruments that they are not equal, and so they change the sound slightly.
So yeah? That's one fundamental pitch with all the overtones.
Yeah, that's exactly. This. So, and here you see the sonogram of this playing. And you see, when it's played very quietly, you have only a few overtones. When you put more pressure on it, as I said, the pulse shapes differently. You have the pulse, the periodic pulse you put in with your lips, they will become sharper. And when they become sharper, then you get more overtones. And in the end, you see something funny. That's what normal brass players shouldn't do. You get a change. You don't get pure overtones, but they sound a bit queer because they how did you call it?
Cracking
the notes.
Yeah.
So at this point, I will see. Yeah, and another thing is when you start playing an instrument, it takes a while till the oscillations become steady. So in the beginning you have different oscillations when it's being steady, and that's how you distinguish between instruments. I will show you in a moment, when we did some experiments, how you can change those, and then if you change For instance, if you cut off the first oscillations, you wouldn't, in many cases, you wouldn't recognize the instrument. I mean, for instance, if you take a piano and play a note and cut off the first 10 milliseconds, then it sounds like a guitar. Because the piano, the noise of the hammer coming on the strings and the reaction of the strings is essential for the sound of the piano. And the same is true for all instruments, for violins, for brass instruments, for flutes, for... here, and this is part of the system, because what you do with all the instruments, you have an external generator. This is your mouse, or the string, or the glottis, and then you have a resonator. So, if you have a resonator, say a pendulum, and you excite that, then it will first start with a frequency which is according to the pendulum itself. But you could excite it with a different frequency. So in the end, it will have the different frequencies. And that's what you call a transient. In the beginning, you have a different frequency from the steady state when the instrument runs. And the transient is essentially the resonance frequency of the instrument. And the other is a frequency of this, or the period of the sound you, of the sound of the excitation you put in. So this is a steady state movement, and if the frequency of the instrument is different, then it will start with this frequency, and then finally get to the frequency of the exciting pulse or whatever you put in. So, could we now play a bit? So we have a tuba here and a trumpet here, and I will try to... You start, ladies first. But let me just set up. So can you just play something? I want to see. I just want to see if the... I will show you in. So. So the loudness you see at the bottom, and okay, thank you. So this is the voice, and this is the beginning. See, this is the transient of the tuba, and and in the end they have more or less uniform. You see, you have uniform waveforms. Maybe do it. So you see, it changes a bit, but not very much. You see, you have this and here, and then it changes a bit. So I will. This is a time picture. Now I will go into the frequency picture, and then we will see. And this, of course, is... Yeah. So. Now, you see, the fundamental and the overtones here, I have to make it a bit, you see the fundamental is here and the overtones come, so you have about 10 overtones and then the other overtones are much, much weaker. I don't know, because the microphone, maybe I can turn down the microphone, when you really play loud, then... let's see. You see here the number of overtones is different depending on how loud you play. And I have to see if I can. I will. So. Can you play again? Can you play louder? So you see, I will have to roll. You see, when it becomes louder, then you get more overtones, and if you don't get overtones, you get noise in the for the high frequencies. This edge is an artifact of the computer. For real recordings, I have a different. Different box to put into the USB slot, and then that goes actually to 20 kilohertz. But this is just a chip on the computer, is not good enough. But it's to demonstrate, it's fine. So, we do the same with the trumpet. Let me just start. Okay. Okay, thank you. And you see that you have sort of vibrations on the frequencies. Here you can see the scale going up, but here you see vibrations, and the vibration is in the fundamental, but it will be enhanced when you go to the overtones, because it's a multiple in the overtone. It's a linear scale, so if you have a tense overtone, then you get 10 times the amplitude for the tense overtone. So you can see it easier, and you see up here you can see the vibrations, and here unten you can't, here below here you can't see it. So it's quite a neat method to look at the overtones. Now we do something else. We want to play the trumpet into the tuba. And the tuba, you see, those are all resonance instruments. Now, if you put another resonator near, then you have an effect. I've done that once, and if you you don't play, you just open the valves. So the tuba only opens the valves and changes the resonance properties of the tuba, and the trumpet plays just does the note. But let me record it. Then let's see. So you, yeah, like this, exactly.
Like that?
Hmm? And you, hmm? Can you do it faster?
Okay.
Hmm? Okay, thank you. So.
So you were opening and closing the valve?
Yeah. So yeah, the resonance changes.
Yeah.
But the trumpet doesn't change anything, but because of the resonance change, you get an effect on the. So I have to see if I can. So. It's sometimes difficult to see. So have to make it a bit. So so here is enlarged. You see the ground frequency changes, sort of. And you have the modulation from the tuba on the bass frequency of the trumpet. Of course, I mean, this is a fact which is important, because if you have an orchestra and you have lots of instruments, they all interfere with each other. The same is actually true for piano, because you have so many strings. You know, the digital pianos, you have the different strings recorded, but a real piano, it depends on what you do with other keys, even if they're not hit. So it's very, to be really a good synthesizer for piano, you have to do a lot of programming. To actually have to program every combination of every string on the piano, which is of course very difficult. Yes, I think that's for the tuba. Now let me see. I don't have to play you the notes. I can, because we have had just a live demonstration. I wasn't sure when I prepared the talk if I would get anybody. Well, I mean, it's when I have my lectures in Berlin, it's difficult, because sometimes the people don't appear. Usually I try to get one instrument per lecture, and if they don't come, I mean, you have to do something. And so, now, let me see. Here is, again, if you look at the impedance as a function of frequency for a trumpet, then you get these maxima, which correspond to the overtones you have seen. You see the lower ones, they are rather sharp. Now what you have to do with a trumpet is you have to produce a tone which sits in here, because then it's amplified. If you go in the middle, you wouldn't hear anything. But the unfortunate thing is, because of the damping, those things become very broad at higher frequencies. So if the trumpet goes up to, how high can you play? try to play as high as you can. Then first of all, the frequency is not defined, and secondly, it's very hard to get a steady tone, because it will wobble between over the whole. I mean, over the whole envelope of this pulse. Yeah. Yeah. But you hear that when he goes up, it's not steady, and he goes between different notes, and actually, because the is always multiple of the base frequency, you have 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5, you get different intervals. The 1 to 2 is an octave, the 2 to 3 is a quint, and the 3 to 4 is a quart. That's how the scales have been developed. This 4 to 5 is a large third, and then 5 to 6 is a small third, and then you would go, if you start with C, 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 G, C, E, G, and then something between A and B flat, and then C again. And it's from English book, so it's this is for a trumpet in B. The instruments are tuned to a particular frequency. In the old times, they didn't have valves, so the trumpet players had to play up here, because the notes were close enough, and that was very difficult. And or you like Mozart, you write just something which has only a quint and quarts, and so if you have those hunting pieces, you get with thirds, and you don't have any tones in between. And only through the introducing those valves, where you have the extension so that it has half a tone higher, half a tone lower, one tone lower, and 1.5 tones lower. And if you combine all of them, then you can go up to 5 tones, 6 tones lower. So, and that's just 1.5 tone below a quint. The next one, the quint, is the next natural tone which you can do, and then so you can get all the tones, except for the so-called pedal tone. That's the octave below the lowest one. So the lowest one, you can you play pedal tones?
You want the low pedal.
Yeah, go. So that's a pedal tone, and that's very difficult to play. Okay, so now let's see. Here's this. I now come to the human voice. Well, that's already. But and maybe we leave the, and the human voice is essentially the same as a trumpet. You have a similar form of pulse, and here you have instead of the tube, you have the cavities of the throat, of the mouth, and of the nose, and you produce through these through the larynx pulse, a sequence of pulses that have a spectrum like I showed you with triangular pulses. Now you have a filter. The filter is your mouth, your throat, and your nose. And this is not a tube. It's three-dimensional. So you get this spectrum convoluted with this spectrum. So you get mainly the frequencies through which are coincidence with these maxima of your throat and mouth and nose room. And by changing the interior of your mouth, you can change these maxima and get different frequencies emitted. And that's how the human voice works. And if you look at if the human body would have had a cylindrical tube in your in mouth, then you would have four frequencies which would be relevant for the filter. But as you change your mouth and your tongue, you change the cross section of your interior of your head, then this would be the frequencies for tubes, then you change those frequencies here. So you change the ratio of the frequencies, and you change the appearance of the different sounds which come out, and that's how you produce your vowels. Each vowel has a particular for the first two. These are called formants. That's sort of broad resonances, and these formants describe, or they are responsible for the different sounds of different vowels, and they are always the same, nearly for women, for men, for children. So that's why you can understand each other without. I mean, otherwise you would, everybody would make different noises. And if you look if you take these first two frequencies and plot them against each other, then you get for different vowels different ratios. This is in kilohertz, this is 1,000 hertz. So if you pronounce an A, then you have about for the second frequency 1,200 hertz, for the first one 1,000 hertz. A U, you would have 300 hertz for the first one, and 700 hertz for the second one. An E, would be up here. So you have a low frequency for the first one and a high frequency for the second one, and that's how you distinguish. And if you have different languages, those patterns are in different parts. So if you have a Dutch people, they have those patterns somewhere else. And so you can, from the sound, from the ratio of this frequency, you can actually find out where the person comes from. And let's see what. I think so. Let me cook up. So, yeah, I want to show you something, and no. And this is particularly interesting for the singing voice. And this, I will play that for you. So, you can see several things here. I will just enlarge the first part, and so. So what we can see, first, we see the orchestra. A bit vibrato, you can see it here. Then you see the overtones of the singer. This is a basic, the fundamental. It's hardly to be seen, you see. And you see a lot of intensity up here. And the singers, they are trained that they have not the F1 and F2, the first two formants. They are the ones which you need for speech recognition. And they use the higher ones to make a big resonance. I will show you in a moment. That means in this area, you will have very high intensity. And if you look, compare with an orchestra, the singer is much higher, has much higher intensity than the orchestra. That's called the singer's formant. And the training of a voice is partly to develop the singer's formant. That's another way of getting a resonance in your head. Then you see that he uses vibrato. And the vibrato is used for different things. First of all, it makes it more lively. And secondly, you get better onto the formants. If you are beside one of the formants, then it doesn't sound. So you have to try to be on the formant all the time. The third thing is, if you look here, that's the beginning. I play it in a moment again. You start, the singer starts half an octave too low. Nah, that's what he does in the beginning. That's on purpose. I mean, people say, sometimes say they don't know how to sing. And this is particularly interesting. And what you see here as well, you see sort of a noise. That's a clapping. And this is, the text is Nessun Dorma. Nobody should sleep. And it's ne, sun, e, u, o, and a. So you have four vowels in. So this is repeated one octave lower. But you see the formants are at the same position. They change only the fundamental, but the formants are kept at the position where they were. And I will try to point out to you. Let's see. So, the first is an E, an A, an E. So you have something here and something here, far apart. And the last one is an A, you have something here, both together. And now I will try to, I can make a cut through that. This is for one particular moment the spectrum. But one can do something else. One can I will try to make an average and do the same. No, so here's the average, and we have to see. That's just a scaling. And what you see here, of course you have, the fundamental is not the same because it changes the tone all the time, but you have the singer formant here. That's always at the same position. And that's, in the orchestra has a spectrum which looks like that. So he's, and I will show you, now, another one. I've got two Pavarotti and Domingo, and you will see in a moment, and then this will be the last. I think I will skip the violin tonight. It's too late already. So this was 17 a.m. So you see a similar. So I will do the same. I'm trying to see. You see again the vibrato is more than in the last case, and the pulling up of the note is more, it's higher, so it's yes, and there's no clapping. So, and now I will try to. And you see the. No, let me do it this way. You see this, the formant is much broader. As before you had sort of a narrow one, and now you have a broader one. So people can actually. See, you can hear that, and you say, well, this is a singer, this is a singer, this is a singer. That's just. But you could see it from here. And the last thing I want to show you is. I used this program. You can put a filter in and cut this singer's format out. And so that we'll see. So let me see here. So this is the same. The first one is without cutting. Then I cut it out that it's about this straight through, and the last one is just cut it out altogether. Orchestra is about the same loudness. And the third one. So you can just cut it down, and then it sounds like, I mean, of course, he is educated, and his voice is educated. You can hear that he's a good singer, but it's not as loud and not as transparent as it is without cutting out. What you can do as well is the opposite. You have a normal singing, and then you enhance the singer's format, and then it sounds like a very good singer. That's why people try to sing in the bathroom, because in the bathroom you have resonances. Usually it's tiled and have good resonances, and that enhances the voice. Yeah, I think I wanted to show you a few things about music. I want to show the violin. Haoxing Lin, he brought the violin, but we better stop at this point, otherwise it will become too late. Thank you.